we, that you would be mindful of us. What do you see that's worth looking our way? We are free in ways that we never should be. Sweet release, grips of these chains, like hinges straining from the wick. My heart no longer keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you alone. Don't deserve your glory. Still, you show a love we cannot afford. Like hinges draining from the weight, my heart no longer can keep from singing. All that is within me cries for you alone. Such a tiny offering compared to Calvary. Nevertheless, you lay this at your feet. All that is within me cries for you alone.
Now, God's richest peace and blessings to you today. I've always loved that song by Mercy Me. It's always been one of those songs for me, at least in recent memory, that really kind of seems to capture the essence of not only the season, but what it is that God brings to us and what we lay before Him. So welcome to this second Sunday in Advent as we focus, continuing our focus on the saints of the season, heroes of the season. Today in our worship, at least tomorrow, since we're here today, Saturday recording, But tomorrow happens to be the feast of St. Nicholas, the real St. Nicholas of Myra. We'll talk a little bit about him in our service today. But it really is, when you think of him and you think of John the Baptist, it's really all about the gift. And it's about the gift that they bring to us, that God brings to us through them and through their ministry to bless us not only this season but for our entire lives. So welcome to the second Sunday of Advent. If you are joining us online, we do post our bulletin and also all of our worship materials, a copy of the sermon, at tlckeen.org, and you are more than welcome to join us there to access those and all of our other worship resources, along with my daily devotionals as well. So welcome. So why don't we join together as we remember our baptism by calling God's name once again upon us in the invocation. Page 2 of your worship folders. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Since we are gathered to hear God's word and to call upon him in prayer and praise, and to receive the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism, you declared us to be your children, and you gathered us into your one holy church in which you daily and richly forgive us our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Restore us, O God, and let your face shine that we may be saved. Give ear, O Shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock. For you are enthroned upon the cherubim. Shine forth. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine that we may be saved. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being of the Church of God and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen.
Light of the world, you stepped out into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart. God.
Gracious Lord, in this holy season of preparation, continue your road work in us. Raise the valleys of our guilt, lower the mountains of our pride. Prepare in us a royal highway, straight and level. Comfort us who are in sorrow or despair. Lead us to the babe at Bethlehem and beyond, trusting always in your enduring promises. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. So as I noted in our reading today, this is the first of two Sundays that are dedicated to the ministry and the service of John the Baptist. So the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter, glory to you, O Lord. The beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, after me comes one who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We join together in confessing the second article of the Creed and the explanation from the Small Catechism. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. What does this mean? I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed me, a lost and condemned creature, purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, live under him in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, even as he is risen from the dead, lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. Amen. If you have your Bibles or your bulletins, I would invite you to open up to the first chapter of Mark's Gospel that begins with these arresting, powerful words, the beginning of the Gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Well, it is Clement Clark Moore who is partially to blame. Writer and professor of literature, as well as divinity and biblical learning, little did Clark realize that his poem, written to entertain children, would eventually become the narrative of Christmas. "'Twas the night before Christmas, when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas would soon be there." Entitled A Visit by St. Nicholas, the new narrative of he who at one time might still have been known and revered as he truly was now reduced to almost Christ-likeness, but unchristian. But we can't have Christmas without Christ, or John's Advent either, for that matter. Where John brings us to it, where his role cannot be diminished, John, like St. Nicholas, delivers the true gift of Christmas. He who comes to save makes it all about you and me. We, not he, are the reason for this season. Where in taking a journey into the wilderness of our sin, Jesus is glad to meet us there with his grace. It is all about me, Jesus says, but I am all about you. Amen. Well, the Savior is about to arrive and nobody notices anything. So notes Francis Fernandez in his reflection on this Sunday's reading. He says, the world goes on as usual, completely oblivious. Where the world is in darkness and few live in expectation of the consolation of Israel. Welcome to 30 AD. Though it could just as well be 2020 in the year of our Lord, where the world for the most part is still in darkness and just as few are expecting the consolation of Israel. I can't recall a single reference to the Savior Jesus Christ in mainstream media these past 10 months. Not one. Outside of the context, perhaps, of trying to shut him down, to mask him, and to silence him. But rather to heed him, not only his words of condemnation, but also his words of consolation. Few, as in Jesus' day, expect his arrival. But John the Baptist did. Given two Sundays in the season of our calendar, we're given a window into the plan of God, a plan that heralds this new covenant that is on the horizon. Indeed, the whole of John's life is encapsulated in this one thing, and that is to make ready the coming of the Son of God. I must decrease, he once said of himself, so that he may increase. This is why John came, why he was born, why he carried out his task to the full, even to the point of fulfilling his vocation with death. That was John's purpose. And how many would come to know Jesus through John's work? Indeed, it may be that we ourselves can trace our own spiritual ancestry to this prophet of the Lord. A gift himself, entrusted with bringing another gift, the gift, to not only us but to the world. Not unlike St. Nicholas of Myra, also a gift giver. Perhaps you know his story. But I just give you a few snippets from Will Wheaton's book, Celebrating the Saints, where he talks about Nicholas, of course, being born in what is called present-day Turkey, orphaned at a young child, taken in by a pastor, an uncle, his who also was a pastor. Among the fathers, he gathered at the Council of Nicaea. Now keep in mind how critical that is, where it was at the Council of Nicaea that the divinity of Jesus was established once and for all. Nicholas was there, confessing boldly this Jesus, this Son of God. Of course, the stories of Nicholas's kindness perhaps are well known, about him contributing money to several young girls' dowry and the like. But he was also beloved by sailors because, according to tradition, he was on a ship threatened to crash, to wreck, but through his prayers he was able to save the sailors, and so he becomes the patron saint of sailors as well. That because of those gifts, those acts of charity on his part, his feast day, December 6th, is actually still celebrated in parts of our world. For Germany, for instance, where it's common for the saint to arrive in full bishop's regalia to the little children. Wheaton concludes, what lives on in the church is a day to celebrate a man of orthodox faith, devout prayer, shaped by the love of Christ, who delighted to bestow his gifts to children. Thanks be to God through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for John the Baptist and for people like Nicholas. Again, who are witnesses to this great gift, who are bringers of not only little trinkets, as it were, in his case, or toys, or whatever, as we think, that that's not even him. We think of one who brought us the faith and of the confession. That is what he and John brings us to on this second Sunday of Advent. First and foremost, a face, a promise that's fulfilled, beginning the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. John heralded, he put a face to this fulfillment of God's promises. Don't let the brevity of Mark's Christmas story annoy you. There are no angels there. There are no shepherds. There are no magi. Just the gospel. The good news of Jesus Christ. Where Mark says, hear me out. And you will hear the sound of this sweet, sweet gospel that is about to ring out in this world. The good news of Jesus Christ, who comes to suffer, but comes as the Son of God to give you life. This is God's gift to you, to me. Mark heralds that good news of great joy, heralded by angels, believed on by the Magi, proclaimed by the shepherds, come to us in our time, at this moment, this planet, this place, your life. That's what John and Nicholas bring us to. Where secondly, they also bring us to the forgiveness that God brings. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, and all of the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem, by some estimates, that's 300,000 people. All of them were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. What is it that in proclaiming the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, people want to lay down the bad news of their lives? It's because they come face to face with grace. They come face to face with the goodness of God. It's not unlike the story of a particular Sunday morning service where the pastor stood at the back of the church, and in typical fashion, although not in our day, he was doing elbow bumps, but in the old days, we used to shake hands with people, and this one guy comes out one day and he goes, powerful sermon, pastor, thoughtful, well-researched, I can always see myself in them, and I want you to knock it off. That's what the good news does. That in the face of this grace, this overwhelming love of God, it humbles us to the point that we want to confess our sins, to lay them down, to lay them down. That's what this second Sunday of Advent brings us to. And there's no more obvious solution to sin than this, than to Jesus. Repent, be honest, come clean, unload the unfruitful patterns of your behavior. What could be better news than that? Because we know that in laying those things down, our lives are filled with the grace of God, with the gifts of God, with his life, with his salvation. In fact, we confess this. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. We as Advent travelers must make this journey because it is there that hope and grace and life and all of the gifts of God meet us face to face. That's what Nicholas and John bring us to. Not only a face that is the fulfillment, not only to forgiveness, but in third place to faith, issuing forth from this fountain of life. Now, John was clothed in camel's hair, and we know that story, but he comes and he says, I've been baptized with water. I baptize you with water, but he who will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Child of God, what would be the best gift in the entire world to you today? The best gift. Think about that for a second. I suspect for many of us it would be that this whole COVID thing would just like disappear. What other gifts might we want today? A new job, a new car, a new bicycle, new television? What is it that we would want? There are so many things that we imagine will make our lives better. But again, what gift is the greatest gift that God could give? It is, again, the face to this fulfillment, this prophecy. It is this forgiveness that God gives. It is this faith that He gives. I baptize you with water, but He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. Here identified as one of the greatest gifts and one of the greatest treasures that you and I could ever possibly receive. The gift of life through the water and the Word. Where such a gift finds itself in one source, one fount, one founder, one foundation, and that is Jesus Christ Himself. This is what Advent, this is what John, this is what Nicholas brings us to Jesus. Jesus. Only Jesus. But also to face ourselves, whom God so loved that He sent His one and only Son into the world, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This is the core of Nicholas's faith and of John's faith and of our faith. I love what Cyril of Jerusalem writes about John. He says, John fed on locusts to make his soul grow wings. Sated with honey, the words he spoke were sweeter than honey and of more profit. Clothed in the garment of camel's hair, he exemplified in his own person the holy life. And so now, with the call to go forward, with the face to the fulfillment, with the forgiveness that God brings, and with the faith that He gives, founded in Christ alone, we are brought finally to fulfill God's purposes for our lives. To go forward in the same spirit, in the same confession, to witness to Christ. Questions of Advent bring us to who it is that could use that good news in our life today. Those who do not love Him, those who have mistaken ideas about Him, is our life a proof, or does it at least point to the likelihood of this truth of Christianity centered in Jesus Christ? This is what Mark brings us to, our witness. The witness to the great hope that we have in Jesus. That blessed hope that is centered in Him. That blessed hope that is centered in His grace. Where at the end of the day, you and I don't really bring anyone to faith. God does that through the power of His Holy Spirit. But how joyful at the end of the day to know that we serve as the Lord's vessel. Like John. Like Nicholas, wherein as nobody can give what he does not have, and the effort to grow in our interior life becomes all the more urgent, says Fernandez, so that all that we meet and pass on the road can be infected by our super abundant love for God. If you were asked to choose the dominant symbol for our generation, what would it be? McKenna, in his commentary on Mark, says that his choice would be the finger pointed to the air, accompanied by the chant, "We're number one." The symbol where winning has come dangerously close, he says, to being everything. Unlike the Reformation artist Matthias Grunewald, who in his Eisenheim altarpiece has a portrait of John standing beneath the cross with the open Bible in one hand and his finger out of proportion to the rest of his body pointing one place, and that is to Jesus. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is John's purpose, basically to get out of the way so that everyone else can see Jesus. It is the greatest gift to us. The greatest gift we might give to each other. Some might say Jesus is the gift that keeps on giving. Dare I say it? Merry Christmas. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. So at this time, we'd like to just spend a few minutes in prayer. And if you are joining us online, we are on page 9 of our worship folders today, as we spend some time in prayer to remember not only God's people here in this place, but other places as well. And if you have a petition that you would like to for us to include, please either email that to us at tlckeen.org or to phone that in or what have you. And there are prayer cards for others in the back to fill out. So let us join together in a time of prayer, page 9 of your worship folders. Again, for those that are able, I invite you to please stand. Let us come before our Lord in prayer, asking Him to hear our prayer and, to grant us peace. Lord of peace, during this Advent season, prepare our hearts to be made ready to receive your Son as He comes in His incarnation and birth. Make us ever ready for His final coming on the last day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant us peace. Lord of peace, you have called your church to bear witness to Christ's redeeming work. Raise up faithful and loving teachers of your word so that Christ may be proclaimed near and far. Grant us also to be instruments of your grace as we boldly proclaim the good news of the one who even now is bringing joy to the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of peace, you are the creator and the sustainer of all things. According to your will, grant healing to all of those who suffer in body and mind. Look with favor upon your servants, Bob and June and Rose. Look with favor upon your servants, Carolyn and Scott's sister and Liz and Uncle Mo and Naomi and Norma and Fred, Diana and Abby, Paula, Tara, Frank, Mike, Doris, Christian, Linda, Katie. Gracious Father, we ask your blessings upon them. Even as we pray your blessings upon the Lambert family and the Islin family and the Jensen family, all of whom have lost loved ones, gracious Father, we commit them to your gracious care, asking for your peace and your blessing, for your healing and your strength. And if it is your will to restore them to health, give them grace to accept tribulation, knowing that your grace is sufficient for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant us peace. Gracious Father, we pray for our families of the week. This week for the Kozakowskis, the Lape, and the LaRiviere family. Just asking, gracious Father, that you would continue to bless them and to give them grace and strength and peace to their homes and to their lives, Lord. Hear our prayer. We pray for our school and for all of our teachers and staff, and especially for our principal, George, Father, even as we lift up the health and the well-being of all of our families and members and friends. We remember the birthdays of Rich and Pauline, Abby and Carolyn, Stella and Bob and Lexi, and ask that you would continue to fill their lives with good things, gracious Father. Thank you. Lord of peace, thank you for calling us to be your people through holy baptism. Now make us ready to receive your supper as we remember the one who is truly present in this meal as he comes to us in Holy Communion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer and grant us peace. Where into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy and your promise to hear us for the sake of the one in whose name we come and who also taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. We invite you to join in singing our last song today. It may seem, again, a little premature, but again, this is the gift that God calls us to. It's called Joy Has Dawned. Once again, if you're joining us online, we thank you for joining us today for worship. Look forward to hearing and seeing from you. Again, tlckeen.org will provide you with all of the resources that you possibly could need. Have a blessed Advent, and we'll see you next week. Amen.